Good afternoon, and welcome to Symphony Nova Scotia. We're so excited to see you again. Before we start, we'd like to acknowledge that we are in Mi'kma'ki, the ancestral and unceded territory of the Mi'kmaq people. These fusion sessions are supported by Factor, by the Canada Council for the Arts, and by O'Regans. Thank you, and enjoy.
Thank you very much. I am thrilled to have been invited to take part in this Fusion Series concert with Symphony Nova Scotia. The COVID-19 pandemic has been catastrophic for the arts all over the world, and that is certainly the case here in Nova Scotia as well. And we, as musicians, have seen our passion and our work drastically curtailed, and it remains to be seen what the landscape of our industry will look like once Corona is in our rearview mirror. But what has been wonderful to see is the ingenuity and resourcefulness which has been brought to the fore as we find creative ways to keep culture alive and to bring our music to you. The various online concerts like this one being presented by the Symphony are just one example of that creativity. The Symphony invited me to do this concert, and they asked me, what do you want to sing? And this is a luxury not usually afforded to us, as we are normally invited to participate in a program that has already been determined. So it has really been a delight to work collaboratively with the Symphony to handpick a few pieces which are close to my heart, which were then reorchestrated to match the orchestra membership and to fit with the numbers allowed by the current COVID protocols. The first piece on the program is an aria from Bach's Cantata No. 51, Jauchzet, Gott, in Allen, London. And Bach is a composer that I sang a lot as a student. My teacher was a particular specialist in that repertoire, but I have not had the opportunity, in my opinion, to sing nearly enough Bach in my professional life, so I really jumped at the chance to include this very joyful aria in this program. And it's actually really a duet between the soprano and the trumpet. The second piece on the program is the fourth movement of Fanny Mendelssohn's delightful string quartet in E-flat major, which really shows off the beautiful and lively chamber playing of four members of Symphony Nova Scotia. The third piece is the first aria of Bachianas, Brasileiras, number 5 by Villa-Lobos. It's a wonderful piece, originally scored for 8 cellos, which even pre-COVID is quite a difficult thing to accomplish with most orchestras. But it has been very beautifully arranged for our forces here by Chris Palmer. And finally, Richard Strauss is a composer who's been central to my career, and it's especially poignant to me that we have included him today, because my next contract after this one was to have been his opera Arabella in Vienna at the Staatsoper. And we just got word about an hour ago, not surprisingly, that all cultural events in Austria have been shut down for a month due to the pandemic. It's basically a complete lockdown. So the opening line of this song, which in English translates to "And tomorrow the sun will shine again," seems especially fitting. We will continue to make music in full trust that indeed the sun will shine again. Thank you.
Oh,
Jane Archibald, it's just wonderful to have heard you sing. I have to say, it's such a wonderful thing.
Oh, thank you.
What a treat for us.
For me too, really.
Okay, so here are some of the questions. Some of the opera houses in Europe have loges or boxes. Others are more open. Do you find the acoustics more singer-friendly in one of these types of houses? And do you have a favorite house as far as the acoustics are concerned?
Oh, that's interesting. I do have a favorite house as far as the acoustics are concerned, but I would say it's the exception rather than the rule. In Toronto, it's the new opera house. Well, it's not that new. I guess it's 10 years since it opened, the Four Seasons Center for the Performing Arts. I walk onto that stage and I feel like I can sing anything and I can sing the most pianissimo note and that you just feel the hall pick it up and take it to the back. But that is not at all, I mean, they do have some boxes, but generally it's a very modern theater. But I think generally speaking, those horseshoe-shaped theaters like the Staatsoper in Vienna with loges all around going up many levels. They have an intimate feeling, even though they seat quite a lot of people, sometimes up to 2,000 or more, because so many of the people are stacked on top of each other, so to speak. There's a feeling of not having to force sending the voice out into a huge cavern. But it really depends on the design. You know, there are some halls that are much, you know, millions and millions of dollars went into them, and then you know, they turn out not to be the greatest acoustic. And so I think there's an element of luck there and planning. But yeah.
We were thrilled when we heard that you made the decision to settle back in Halifax. How has returning...
Yes! Thank you.
I think it's raised the pedigree of Halifax by a big notch.
Well, I don't know that I can take credit for that, but I'm happy to be home.
How has returning to live here challenged managing family and such a demanding schedule around the world?
Well, in all the ways that it has become more complicated, because my career is more based in Europe than in North America, and there's not a singer out there that I know who's happy with the balance. Whoever's singing more in Europe wishes they had a little bit more in North America and vice versa. But however challenging that has been, and it has been, because it means if I get a weekend off, I can't fly home for the weekend. It's just not feasible with transatlantic flights. It has been more than made up for by just feeling like when I do come home, I am really home. I love my house. I love the creak of my stairs. I love the, you know, my home coffee machine and my neighborhood and the view out my bedroom window and all of that just feels like home. And I think I realized when I left, and I left Nova Scotia at 18, and I was in Ontario to study and to start my career, and then San Francisco, and then Vienna. And then after I got married, I was based in the countryside of Austria because my husband had a house and a son there. I realized just how much of a Nova Scotia girl I am, and I was not a particularly happy expat. I did my best. I think it's a really wonderful opportunity to go and live somewhere else and be forced to be an immigrant and to experience that. But it was a challenge, you know, the language, the different culture, even just something as simple as going to a doctor's office or filing your tax return takes so much more. So to come home to a culture that was familiar and people and their way of being and their way of talking and just very friendly and direct and down to earth, that grounds me. So it makes it all worth it.
Great, lucky for us. Have you sung any Verdi roles? And if not, are there any that you would like to sing?
Have I sung any Verdi? I should know the answer to that question. I have covered and learned Verdi roles. I covered Gilda when I was at the Staatsoper as a young woman in my 20s, but I never did any rehearsals or performed it. I've learned Violetta because I don't care if I'm 90 years old, I am not leaving this earth before I've sung that role. That's on my wish list. There's not a ton of Verdi for me, well, at least in my earliest incarnation as a lighter coloratura, there wasn't all that much for me. But, you know, as I move into my 40s and the voice has warmed up through the middle, you know, I'm exploring other options. But for sure, Gilda might still be in the cards, not for too much longer, but and Violetta is on my wish list, yeah.
What inspired you to become a soprano, and mostly, how did you find your voice?
Well, I wasn't inspired to become a soprano. I just was a soprano. You're just sort of discover what is naturally there. I grew up in Truro, as many people may know, which is an exceptionally musical community for its size, the amount of high-quality music going on, especially during the years that I was growing up, was quite incredible, just on all fronts. School music, the band program, the First Baptist Girls Choir, and the music festival, and the number of people taking voice lessons was just, like, per capita was kind of crazy. I don't know, I don't have the statistics, but I think it was quite a lot. So I grew up kind of immersed in that. My father was a physician, but played piano at home. So I was always singing, but I was extremely self-conscious. And I suppose shy, but I've kind of, you know, in hindsight, I kind of look back and I feel like it was really more a self-consciousness. And I found it very hard. I had an inner struggle. I wanted very much to sing. I loved music. I loved singing, like, in school, in a group. And I knew I had a confidence. I knew I had a voice very young, but the idea of walking up on stage and being that vulnerable to sing a solo was very difficult. But I pushed myself, as anyone in this profession has to do. You push yourself beyond your comfort level over and over and over. And I started taking lessons from a wonderful singer and teacher named Leslie Lake Searle when I was 11, which is quite young. And she definitely was instrumental in nurturing and taking care of a young voice. I think she probably knew that there was a lot of potential there. And I realize it more with each passing year, how lucky I was, because I was introduced to Bach and Mozart through band and choir and my voice lessons very early. And I started singing quite poorly, I'm sure, but that's how you start, in languages, French and German and Latin, as a young teenager already. And I just soaked it up. I loved it. And she protected the voice and didn't push it, you know, during those years when it's very, quite vulnerable. And then I think it was clear that I was some kind of a soprano at that point. But I didn't actually identify as a coloratura soprano until my mid-20s. The penny finally dropped. Someone said to me at the Met competition, in kind of an exasperation, if you can sing Lacme's Bell Song, why the heck didn't you open with that when you know, she was very frustrated with, because I had this kind of smorgasbord of repertoire, Pamina, you know, which is the lyric role and not the coloratura role, coupled with, you know, and it was all kind of all over the map. But it takes everybody time to kind of zero in on what their niche is. And then sometimes you can get a little bit stuck in it. So now I'm at the other end of that tunnel, kind of going, excuse me, I'd like to sing, not be quite so straitjacketed into that repertoire. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, one more question. You were the artist in residence at the Canadian Opera Company in 1718. Is this a program that many opera companies have adopted? Does it involve working with students or almost professionals? And what was the most memorable production that you were part of that year?
I'm not sure I can answer the first part of that question, which is, you know, the number of opera houses that have adopted that. Certainly, I don't think that's something that's happening as much in Europe, where there are just far more performances and the number of artists going through a house in a given year is, you know, in the hundreds. I have seen it happening in different versions with orchestras and in opera houses in North America. I think it's a little bit kind of somewhat based on chance. There happened to be three roles that would have been appropriate for me, and I was free, and I think originally, you know, it was like, well, which one would I most want to do? And then it later became clear that, well, maybe we could have you do all, you wouldn't have to pick, you could do all three and you can be an artist in residence. And we sort of fleshed it out. But I absolutely did work with the young artists of the ensemble program. I did some coaching, I did a recital. They have a wonderful free noon hour recital series there that anyone working downtown can come to for free if you get there in time. And I did some like PR stuff, and I had somebody follow me around Toronto and like go with me to get a manicure and do this kind of thing. So it was kind of fun, actually. And the three operas I was involved in that season were, I think it was Arabella, mm-hmm. and then Abduction from the Seraglio of Mozart, which is sort of one of my signature roles, I guess. And the last one was The Nightingale. And I think The Nightingale was the most unique experience for me, and I think I sort of get the impression whenever I talk to someone about The Nightingale, I think from an audience perspective, it's such a rich and kind of immersive experience that I hate to burst their bubble, but on the other side of the stage, it was a very strange experience because for those of you not familiar with the production, the orchestra's on the stage behind us and the pit is filled with water. And there are puppeteers, and we are all kind of in a costume, but essentially a costume that's like that of our puppet, and we are providing the voice of the puppet. And so there are acrobatics doing like shadow stuff. I mean, it's incredible visually to see. I mean, it is a wonderful piece of art. But for me, the staging and the characterization and the movement on stage is so tied into the music. All of my decisions come from what my character is doing, or if I'm sitting on the floor or walking across or whatever I'm doing. So I found it quite a strange experience, actually, to try and fill meaning in the sound while being kind of just a soundtrack, if that makes sense. So it was really interesting, and it was my first Russian role, so that was another very steep hill to climb. But I think my favorite production of that season was The Abduction, because I had done the same production when it premiered in Lyon the season before, or maybe two seasons before. And it's a difficult opera, and it's one that we're wrestling with in this day and age, mm-hmm. A lot of opera has this issue because it was written, it was of a time, it's racist and misogynistic and every other thing you can imagine. And it really is, you know, as people who are, you know, woke to that, to these issues now, it can be hard to reconcile. And this production, I mean, I have done so many productions of Abduction, and it's a problematic libretto, and it can be hard to, people try to come at it from so many different ways, but it was a wonderful production in that they didn't change any of the music, which is, it's Mozart, it's sacrosanct, you don't mess with that. But I don't think anybody thinks that the dialogues are particularly, you know, can't be messed with, because they're often cut or abridged. And the director is a Lebanese-Canadian filmmaker and playwright named Wajdi Mouawad. And he's a feminist, and he does a lot through that feminist lens. And so he rewrote the dialogue a little bit and added scenes. And it was a huge amount of work for us as actors, because we had these enormous theatrical scenes in between the numbers. We had this scene at the beginning, which was a party in Vienna to celebrate our successful return. And then we start talking, you know, the guests leave and the main characters start talking, and the women are trying to explain to the men who have rescued them why it's not quite so simple as, well, we're good and they're bad and now you're safe and let's just go back to life the way it was. And so there were all of these scenes, and it was kind of a look back in time, and then we would sort of, you know, meld into the scene and play it and come out again. And it was, I thought it really addressed the issues that quite frankly need to be addressed. And I'm not sure how doable that is for every opera, but we need to find creative solutions that way. And I was really challenged dramatically as an actor as well as a singer.
I'm sure.
I really liked that, because I just love a challenge. So, yeah.
Yeah, I bet that was very interesting. Well, thank you very much, Jane. It's been a delight to speak with you this afternoon.
Thank you.
And thank you to everyone for coming.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.